very excited today. Thank you, Dr. Steven, for telling us about Hearables. I actually found out about Hearables this year. So did anyone else not hear about Hearables, or am I the only one? Okay, I'm the only one?
No,
awesome.
Me too.
Okay,
no, I'm just kidding.
Two people. So to start this off, we know that data accuracy is a big deal, and it's interesting putting all this technology into such a small device. Dr. Steven, what do you think about the technology as we look at athletes? Why is it so great to measure at the ear? What is there at the ear for us to measure?
I think there's three big reasons. One of them is the fact that you could communicate with the athletes because the audio is there. The second one is you can measure things more accurately at the ear than you can other parts of the body. There's physiological reasons why. In the ear, you get this carotid artery system running across your neck, which helps you stay alive, but also that pressure wave there allows you to measure more things. Like, for example, we can measure blood pressure at the ear. We can't measure that same way on the wrist with that technology. So you can measure more and more accurately there. And then also another thing is that the motion artifacts are much less. Because, you know, with the wrist, I mean, look at me talking right now, right? I mean, Cajuns and Italians, we move our wrist around all the time when we talk. Well, I mean, it's challenging to get an accurate reading on people in many, even lifestyle cases, even things like typing, for example, much less exercise with a wrist-worn device. In an ear, you can make an earbud bulletproof. I would say that in our labs, we have seen earbuds that are well-fit, that behave better than chest straps for heart rate monitoring, if you have a good fit.
And I want to take some time to introduce the rest of the panel. We have Carlos and Kim and David. Let's go down the row and just say kind of what you do and why you do it for your company. David, we'll start with you.
So I'm the co-founder of Nuheara. We're bringing to market product called IQ Buds, and we describe them as intelligent earbuds. And essentially what they do is they give you the control to hear what you want to hear in the world around you and connect to your digital devices. And if you think of the product, it's really, the main focus is really to solve a problem. The problem is that we live in a crazy, noisy world, and if you can integrate some really smart hearing technology into two completely wireless earbuds and allow you to connect to your digital devices, we think that's a really strong proposition for hundreds of millions of consumers.
Absolutely. Yeah, we do something similar. AfterShokz makes open ear headphones, bone conduction technology, and that allows us to hear everything around us while we're listening to music and making and taking phone calls. Probably much more simple than the technology that Nuheara does, but we're real sports focused, all about safety and comfort, so.
I'm the CEO of Kuaiwear. We do multi-sport headphones, specifically designed from the ground up to do multiple sports, swimming, running, cycling. We connect to a platform of training plans that you can download. The device has got its own memory, MCU, so the device is smart. You don't need to be connected to a phone. And then using all the sensor technology, the device customizes the voice coaching to every individual. So it's basically like having a wearable coach in your ears that is guiding you through the training plan to make sure you achieve your training goals.
Dr. Steven, one of the things we talked about, I got the pleasure of interviewing you for the Fitness Plus Technology podcast earlier, is that the ear is now this place where sophisticated technology is living. And besides just the everyday user, I mean, we have athletes that have been training with these for how many years?
Oh, Lord. I mean, biometric hearables, that's very recent. As far as training with earbuds for communication purposes, a while. But what's had to happen is a bifurcation of the audio, you know, versus the sensor technology. And then also the fact that the sensor technology a lot of times could potentially even get in the way. And so what you're seeing now is this combination of getting everything that needs to be gotten into one spot where you can get the audio and the biometrics. And that's very new.
And I think from the augmented hearing, David, that's challenging. We talked before we came up here, putting all these intricate sensors into such a small device. I mean, honestly, I'm very grateful that this technology exists, but what are the challenges that are involved in doing that?
Well, you know, there's so many different types of technology that goes into a product like IQ Bud. So if you think about what's in each little earbud, is there's three boards, three microprocessors, two microphones, a speaker, tap touch control, two antennas, and a battery, and the battery takes up 50% of the real estate. So what you're talking about is you bring some DSP technology, you bring some software, you bring some RF technology. I mean, there's all these technology complexities that come together in a product like IQ Buds that represents significant challenges. So, you know, we're a team that's done this plenty of times before, so it's still really challenging, but the fact that we've got a couple of decades experience really helps us.
And Kim, with AfterShokz, you know, my brother is a cyclist. Is anyone a cyclist in the room? any cyclists. So having this open ear technology, tell us a little bit about that and why we can actually get sound from this bone structure on the face.
Well, bone conduction is actually a natural way that we hear sound. If you ever, you know, bite into an apple, you know that crunching noise that you hear sort of inside. That's bone conduction. So we just use that that concept in these headphones, and the sound just travels through your cheekbones, leaves your ears totally open to hear anything else happening around you.
And Carlos, what you do with Kuaiwear, I had read online there was some coaching pieces involved with this. So this is technology that is worn at the ear. You can get a lot of biometrics from that. But then there's also the coaching aspect. Can you tell us about the coaching aspect?
So we have created a platform that allows professional coaches. We have Olympic athletes involved as well. And it allows you to create your own training plans, recording your own voice, and creating basically interval sections. Those interval sections are created based on heart rate, which is the best way to measure your exercise, and then the boys actually coach you and deploy the training plan specifically for you.
You can create it in your own voice?
Yes.
Oh, interesting.
That is cool.
So the athletes create their own voice. We're also talking to personal coaches. So the idea is that the personal coach, it's very expensive, $50, $100 a pod. You have to go to the gym. It's inconvenient, so we're offering a way for consumers to download those training plans at a much cheaper place, much cheaper price, and being able to consume it in whatever situation they are, in the gym, in their local running club, wherever.
That's pretty slick.
Steven, the market you touched on a little bit, I mean, where are we right now? Are we infancy in hearables? Is this like the beginning of the beginning?
It's the beginning of the beginning, really, because, I mean, you know, just biometric headphones. The first biometric headphones to launch, I think we're the beginning of 2014. And you know, it was a slow process to get to where we are now. And to me, it's the confluence of technologies that Valencell provided on the biometric fitness monitoring side, combined with some of these advanced technologies that True Wireless like Nuheara works on. And then you have these use cases like AfterShokz. Your first product was 2 years ago, I believe, is that right?
Four
years ago.
Yeah.
I mean, the use case of being able to ride a bike and listen to music, that really was a very difficult use case. People don't want to wear earbuds when they're riding on bikes. So, I mean, this was a very, I'd say, very new area. I mean, frankly, even wearables are still in a small part, beginning of the beginning, I guess, in a lot of ways, or maybe end of the beginning and beginning of the new frontier. Because, I mean, right now, I think 20 million units of biometric wearables sold last year. I believe I'm right about that. So it's not even in a marketplace yet where hundreds of millions are buying. So these markets are, you know, all relatively infant, I guess, with a lot of growth opportunity, especially hearables.
And with hearables, this augmentation, you know, there's 50 million people plus in America that have trouble hearing what they want to hear. So how is Nuheara addressing that, and what does that look like to actually meet that need?
Well, look, we started with the proposition that we wanted to solve a problem. You know, I mean, I think one of the big problems with the wearables market is there's way too many nice-to-haves out there. And I think you see the trajectory of the share prices on Fitbit, et cetera, et cetera. If you're solving a problem for a consumer, you're doing it in real time, you're doing it effectively, and they understand that their quality of life has improved from the moment they put the product on, I think that's gonna drive growth. And so, there's a massive market out there. 1.1 billion people have got some degree of hearing loss in the world. Obviously, you know, in the developed world, there's a huge market opportunity. And, you know, we're just about really addressing that consumer problem of being able to give them the control to hear what they want to hear. And that's what really drives our business.
What was the, I'm curious, I don't know if anybody else is curious about this. What actually makes it, and maybe Dr. Steven can touch on this, what makes us lose the hearing, and then how does technology help that and support that? You know, people are losing that efficacy for hearing, and then how does it support
that? Well, I mean, from our perspective, we see it, firstly, it's age-related. Secondly, it's profession-related. Our last hearing technology company, we sold smart headsets into the industrial sector. So there's a lot of middle-aged men, blue-collar men that have been working in noisy environments, got noise-induced hearing loss. Hey, we've all listened to a lot of rock music.
Exactly.
And even the kids now who are blasting their ears with headphones, they don't know it, but they're getting slow noise-induced hearing loss. So it is an epidemic in that respect.
But you know, the Nuheara products are about more than just, okay, I've got a hearing issue. It's prevention too, because you can wear the product and focus the sound on what you want to focus the sound on. So it's not, you know, it's really this concept of active listening, different terms. I don't know what terminology y'all use for it.
Yeah, I mean, we don't refer to it as active listening. We refer to it as essentially assistive audio.
Assistive audio
is a really good term.
It's revolutionary.
It's assisting you to control your audio world, both in your environment and digitally.
Yep.
So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the challenge is really sometimes we lose connection and Bluetooth. I mean, I've been working out and I lose Bluetooth. How do we address this issue from a technology standpoint where we can get consistent Bluetooth that doesn't drop, especially for augmented hearing? I mean, how do we do that?
Well, I've got a thought on that.
Yeah.
The phones really contribute. There's such variation across all the phones. Apple do it really well. I mean, we have really good Bluetooth connectivity to Apple. You probably have the same thing.
Sure, but if your phone's in your pocket and the antenna's facing the wrong way, it doesn't matter how good your
They're going to blame it on the headset. Not
they
the
will,
phone.
Well, absolutely.
They do. So you know, I mean, here we are, the small little hearables industry, right? Blaming the smartphone market for lack of Bluetooth connectivity, but there is tremendous variation across all the phones. Mm-hmm. So it represents an interesting challenge for everyone.
You know, Josh, there's a commonality here with biometric monitoring. It's the validation side. And what it amounts to is that when companies that know what they're doing with the Bluetooth, you should see their labs for it. It's extremely sophisticated. A lot of tests, a lot of weird conditions that most companies don't think about. They'll slap an antenna. Sometimes they'll make their own antenna, which is hysterical, and just throw it in there and launch the product, and it doesn't work at all. It's actually, you know, painfully comical. Same thing in the biometric monitoring. The validation required to prove that it really works for the use case, so the validation side is really important, because this is where the things get exposed about, is it really the phone or is it me? And I don't see a lot of, it's easy to just jump right in and cause a problem rather than to do it right.
So for us, it was that was one of the reasons we decided to include a memory inside the device. You can connect to the phone through Bluetooth, but when you do extreme exercising and you go swimming and you go cycling, you do that kind of sports, you don't really want to be connected to a phone or having to operate a phone. So having a device that's got its own, it's everything included, kind of solved that
that's
problem.
That's nice. So you could say, screw the phone.
Yeah.
Look,
and so synchronize
work.
Later. After the workout, you synchronize with it.
I think there's a lot of merit to that, because with our product, for instance, you get 16 hours of on-the-go Bluetooth streaming, but you get 32 hours of hearing processing. Hearing processing doesn't need to be attached to a Bluetooth. You can create your hearing profile on your Bluetooth device and put it down and go about your day for 8 hours until you need to recharge it. So being not attached to that Bluetooth device in the way you deliver that solution to the consumer is definitely an advantage.
Yeah. Does anyone have any questions about the technology that we're seeing in hearables, or what it's going to look like, and what kind of use cases we might be able to see this in?
Any questions, you can raise your hand and I'll bring you a microphone.
So there's a hand up here.
Hi, for the headphones that work through the bone in your ear, when you're riding your bike or whatever, what about the consumers who want to block out some of that noise? So instead of on the bike, they're in the gym or wherever, and they don't want to hear all that outside noise. Do you have a way of dealing or providing for those consumers?
So are you asking if we offer a solution for that?
Yeah,
we do have earplugs that we put in our packages for that, but our whole concept is open ear, because the idea is that you're aware of everything around you. It's more safe and more comfortable.
Yeah, I mean, from our perspective, we essentially give you the control to hear what you want to hear in your environment as well as your digital. So you can actually have situational awareness by opening up your environment or bringing it back down and providing true noise cancellation. So we're about giving you a dynamic range, dynamic control.
Mm-hmm. It's too much power for one man.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
I saw one more hand up here. Did you still have a question? Could we have a mic to the second row, please?
Thank you. I have a question, a two-part question. The first is about comfort. So you touched on that, because even the most comfortable earphones, they become uncomfortable with time. And the second one is hygiene, because if you want to have an earphone for 24 hours, you can imagine what that's going to be like after a couple of days. So if you have any questions or comments, any comments on that.
So the question is about the comfort and the long-term wear. Yeah, so the there's two big things associated with that. One of them is the materials that you use, which, various companies, Jabra, for example, has a lot of sophistication in what materials to use for different earbuds. Another is how you design the earbud for the particular use case. So if it's long-term wear, there's certain designs that don't hurt you as much as others. Now, a general rule of thumb is in an earbud, if you have a feature that is broader than about 3 millimeters, there's 3 millimeters worth of feature there, in more, that's where you're really going to run into troubles. You're going to run into troubles. So those types of design rules have to be in place. And I got to say, no one yet has I think proven that they've solved that issue. I don't think. I'm not aware of anything unless anyone else is. For the very long-term use case, for example, the multi-sport use case, the Kuaiwear guys have worked that out for their use case. But for the extremely long-term wear, I don't know that that's been resolved yet from a material and design standpoint.
Our solution to that is just don't put anything in your ear.
All right.
That's a good solution, yeah. I must say. That is a good solution. From our perspective, we did a lot of research on fit. If you look at the design of the IQ bud, it looks quite different from all the other truly wireless earbuds. It's sort of designed to sort of streamline your ear. So we did a lot of research in that. The other way we're addressing that issue is we're providing 8 different tip sizes when we ship the product. Really important to get a really good occlusion of your ear. Mm-hmm. I think that ultimately I think there's a social thing here as well, that if you see people wearing these earbuds a lot more, thank you AirPod, mm-hmm. they're going to be, people will wear them for longer and more people will wear them. So I think it'll become less of an issue. But yeah, there's a lot of innovation going into fit materials and fit designs.
I haven't yet heard though.
Custom molded and all that sort of stuff.
I haven't yet heard of any hearables burning through people's wrists yet though, so.
Yeah, no, exactly.
Good point.
Yeah. I did hear a person in Australia, actually, last week. I read an article that a young man sliced his neck with a cord. So that was interesting, the cable.
Not intentionally, I guess.
No, it was an accident.
All right.
Love what you guys are doing with these ear products. Question, though, given the technology that's involved in this, the small space that you have to work in, these products right now are very expensive. In the next 3 or 4 years, should we look at the price of these products coming down substantially so that they can become common consumer items?
Well, to my point early in the presentation, it has to. Mm-hmm. It has to happen. The driving forces for that are reduction in the prices of the electronics, the manufacturing getting more in gear, and also the economies of scale with the volumes going up. So, already we're almost to that point, certainly with biometric hearable. Some of the what's interesting is on the biometric side, Valencell has been working on this for so long, a lot of those problems on the biometric side are resolved. But some of the newer features, some of the sophisticated augmented hearing technologies are new. And so, manufacturing and volumes of scale are yet to be certain about how fast those will grow to see how soon we can get to that $99 price point. If you're going to have, combine our peanut butter with that chocolate there for the hearable earbud.
I think you ask a very good question, but I would ask you to think about it in a different way. And that is, what problem are you solving and what's the value out of the product? I think the market is in its infancy and it's taking shape. And there's going to be a lot of $99 hearables, if you want to call them hearables, but they're just going to be dumb wireless earbuds. They'll play music and listen to and take phone calls. Think about in this.
And they might not even do that too well.
They may not even do that too well, exactly. Think about Bose, who's built an amazing business selling $350 headphones with noise cancellation technology. And think at the other end, you talk about the hearing aid companies that have sold products for thousands and thousands, up to $10,000. So in terms of the price range in existing hearables, they're all pretty expensive, but it all comes back to, are you getting the value out of the product that you're buying? And is it worth, in our case, $299? And there's a lot of people that come to our booth that would pay 3 times that to get the benefit of the product that we're selling. So.
Any more questions? I definitely want to leave space to talk about roadblocks, because I'm sure you're all entrepreneurs. It is not easy launching a product. What are some of the things that have really blocked that you think we can extrapolate on in regards to technology? I mean, what technology do we need to have grow or be more of a user interface so that this thing's successful and we have this mass adoption? I'll just kind of toss that out to the group.
Well, I think it's a very exciting time in this space. I mean, you look at artificial intelligence and you know, the sensor technology. I mean, there's so many possibilities that we have ahead of us in the hearable space. I think the world is the oyster. I don't think there's too many roadblocks. I think, I mean, the roadblocks are in the technology capability to be able to integrate these technologies into such a small piece of tech, you know, piece of hardware. So that'd be my perspective.
Carlos, do you think from a sports perspective that you need to see something, sensors inside of your devices? I know that you do a lot with athletes. So from an athletic perspective, what are you seeing that is needed in that space for wearing them on?
I mean, for us, we kind of have to be a bit careful about what we do in terms of, like, we don't want to pack everything we can into the device. Our headphones are actually bigger than all these other guys are doing, because we are sport focused. It's not such an important thing to be ultra miniature. So we need to have a few points of connection. We need to be very secure. It needs to be good for swimming, for doing different kind of exercises, extreme exercises. So we have quite a lot of real estate compared to the other guys, but then we want to be true to our vision, which is really increased performance. Having a lot of different sensors just for the sake of having them, we don't believe it's a good strategy. We don't want to complicate things even more. So yeah, just focus on what we are doing and giving value to the user and really helping them achieve what they want to achieve, the goals, not just adding things for the sake of it.
Dr. Steven, do you feel like there's one thing that you would like to see in the next 6 to 12 months from a technology standpoint that's kind of challenging right now for the industry to make?
Well, boy, you know, being from a technology background, there's tons of things going on in my mind right now. One of the things I would say is, you know, to the Bluetooth issue, that is one of the biggest issues, and we don't have full control over that. And, you know, I got to say, in the year 2025, I hope by that point at least we've got some kind, if man is still alive, we've got some kind of technology that is much better than Bluetooth for this. But, I mean, because that in itself would solve so many issues. You wouldn't believe how much of our time, oh, sweet baby Jesus, in our labs is devoted to Bluetooth. And think about, you know, feel my pain for a moment. You know, we got all these licensees, and we've got to test out their prototypes, make sure they're working right, and then the Bluetooth's not connecting, not because of any fault of theirs or ours, and maybe it's the fault of anyone who's not them or us. And the thing is, now we've lost a whole day's just trying to get the Bluetooth stuff to work out. So yeah, that's what's pulling at my heart right now.
Does anyone on the panel feel like this could be used for a group setting? I mean, we look at the ear being a place to get incredible biometrics. So how could this be used in a group coaching setting or having accountability through a virtual coach? I mean, is that possible with this technology?
Oh, yeah. You know, I'll never forget back in 2011. I think I'm telling you right. 2011, you know, it was that's like after Valencell raised its first round of funding. I was at North Carolina State talking to one of the coaches there, and he was the strength trainer there, and so he did all the strength training for the women and men's teams, and he was at the time training the girls' soccer team, and I explained to him what we were doing, and we were trying to design our technology platform for these folks, and he explained his fantasy situation. He said what he wanted was this interface. He could communicate with all of the people that were being trained at the time, get all the biometric data, and find an easy way to explain to them where they needed to improve. And so I challenged him, you know, I like to play devil's advocate. So I said, well, look, you know, some of the things you need measuring the heart rate, you can just get the girls, the guys, whatever, to stop and just measure the heart rate. He goes, check this out. So he took me out. The girls were exercising, and I'm going to make up a name. I can't remember the girl's name. I can't remember the coach's name right now off the head. But Sheila, he goes, Sheila, what's your heart rate? You know, she just finished doing something. She does this. She goes, 202, coach. He says, see? I mean, you can't expect somebody to capture that data. You know, it's not because, I mean, you know, they're busy training, they can't get those numbers. And so I guess putting that all together is kind of the grand visage for coaches, is to have be able to communicate with them in real time, to be able to get the data in real time, and to know what to get the metrics that are important to the coaches that are important for the training, whether it's the strength training, the cardio training, or whatever the case might be.
Do you see this in scale being used in health clubs in the next 3 years?
Well, you know, already, I know outside of earbuds, since the earbuds are relatively new, what's it, Orange Fitness, I believe, they
Orange Theory Fitness, yeah.
And some of these groups use Skosh products and other products, for example, in their training, their armbands and wristbands. And on the ear side, I totally expect that. And I think one thing that's really gonna help is the advent for the biometric monitoring. For example, AfterShokz technology, if you can put biometrics in that, which we can do, by the way, because oftentimes you wanna hear the coach too. So, you know, if you're measuring at the ear, you want to hear the pass-through. And if you don't have the ear involved, you want to be able to hear the coach and be able to get the exercise done in that particular case.
I want to thank our panelists. What an incredible space. Thank you for your expertise and passion for what you do. Let's give a hand to our panelists, please.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.